Ready, George?
Yes, sir.
2, 3, 4. Take your time and show me I'm in too much of a whirl. And though I'm trying to do what you said do, I'm your date, you said eight, you're my oyster girl. And I won't eat fried oysters without you. You and cocktail sauce, I don't care what they cost, it's worth those high prices. I'm your date and you said eight, and you're my oyster girl. And I won't eat fried oysters without you. It's worth those high prices. And take your time and show me I'm in too much of a world. I won't eat fried oysters without you. Thank you, Adam.
Steve, where'd that song come from? Were you in Houston eating oysters, or like, where'd that come from?
I really don't know. I do like fried oysters, and I.
Me too.
Yeah. So, there you go. I'm not interested in oysters on the half shell. But anyway, that was just. I don't know if you really like something like that, and you. Well, let's write a song about fried oysters, you know? Okay. And it just became this situation, this love song, and somebody waiting for this girl to get ready, let's go, you know, and going out to get some fried oysters. So there you go.
You know, it strikes me as the type of song where you're on the road so much, you travel so much, and you probably eat in so many different kinds of places. And look over at the next table and try to imagine what's going on with the people at the next table. That's Fried Oysters off the new record Moving Through America by our good pal, tonight's guest, Mr. Steve Forbert.
Yeah, and then in typical folk rock fashion, the third verse couldn't stay happy. It had to be something, ominous coming. What about, it was after the hurricane had happened, I guess, when I started it. Mm-hmm. So that came to the front of my mind. Houston Town is on flat ground, which right. we now know pretty well.
Sure.
And what's the next big hurricane going to do?
Mm-hmm.
So it took that turn in the third verse, which is, of course, more serious. But it's I guess, traditional, like a folk song.
Yeah. Well, boys and girls, tough cookies. We have my good pal Steve Forbert with me. We are sitting here at Steve Greenwell's in Asbury Park, New Jersey, on Lake Avenue. And we are just so fortunate to have you here today. We have a lot of fans of yours who watch this show. We got, we always get requests for different people. And I thought that you lived in Mississippi. I did not know that you lived in this area. So I was very pleased that we could get you here in the studio to do this. How long have you been living up here in New Jersey?
I think since 2017.
And
I was in Nashville before that.
Gotcha.
For 27 years or so.
How are you liking living up here in Jersey?
Oh, I like it fine. There was a good root scene when I moved down to Nashville from New York City in 85. There were a lot of different groups, and a lot of them became my friends down there. But that has slowly just sort of, to my knowledge, there may be some Americana acts that are, Nashville has exploded.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
And that may be the thing, but the roots, of course, the roots people have gotten older, and I think the... I don't think the town has as much of that anymore. It was funny. A lot of the people I knew, I never saw them except if I ran into them on tour.
Sure.
Out of Nashville. But so I moved up here, and the music scene here is very, it's stable. It's been like rock and roll.
Oh, yeah.
For decades. And it's in good shape. So I'm very comfortable here.
Good, good. When was the first time you heard the phrase Americana? Because... to me, I'm just old enough that I remember when people used to say alt country or singer-songwriter or roots American music. But these days, people are saying Americana. What do you think of that term, Americana?
It seems fine to me. I was okay with alt country. I was okay with roots music, but... It's a particular thing. It might very often have a pedal steel in it. It's going to have more personal lyrics than your music row country radio song, pretty much, although they might disagree. But the songs, I think, come off more personal.
Yeah.
And aren't typically written by three people.
Right.
So as far as something being called Americana, I like it a lot. I've said it many times. I always wondered. There was pop in the '80s, and there was country, but where was that thing in the middle that the band had just nailed with their first two records? And to me, I've always been a big fan of Gram Parsons since sure. I discovered him. So that to me was a great thing, and this sort of covers that.
Yeah.
So that to me is what the Americana term means. And I like it.
When you were making your first couple records in the late 70s, what did you think your music was? Did you think you were doing rock and roll, pop, folk, singer-songwriter? How would you have described yourself?
I would have probably just said singer-songwriter.
Uh-huh.
I felt like I was in the tradition of... you might say... Gordon Lightfoot had had a few hits right up to that time.
Yeah, sure.
And I felt like I could relate to Jackson Browne and some of the things Bruce Springsteen had done. And I would have said singer-songwriter.
Sure. So there was already this kind of footprint for this singer-songwriter sound. But throughout your career... which you've been making records now for what, like 45 years, I'd say. You have, you know, explored all different corners of, I guess, what you could call Americana. And one of the things that you did that I absolutely loved, you did this Jimmy Rogers tribute record a few years ago. How did that come about?
It came about because I'm from his hometown,
mainly. Is it Meridian?
Meridian, Mississippi. And Jimmy Rogers was the first person inducted into the Country Music Hall of Fame. And he's called the father of country music.
Yeah, yeah. The singing brakeman.
Singing brakeman, America's blue yodeler. And so being from his hometown and making these what we are calling Americana records for, at that point, 20th or more years, it was just like, one of these days I've got to do something special about being from Jimmy Rogers' hometown. So I mentioned this to Gary Talent, and he was producing me at the time, and he was up for it. So we just went ahead and got some of our favorite players together at his studio, and we did it.
I mean, you've done so many songs and records that I love, but that one really impressed me because you just have a feel for that material. And a lot of times when people try to do songs from 100 years ago, from the 1920s and 30s, it has a sort of, I don't know, cheesy quality to it, like they're trying to do like a cartoon version of that era. I felt like your versions, it felt very in touch with the material. Was his music, you know, part of the fabric of the town growing up, or did you sort of come to that music later?
Well, to me, what I wanted to do, I was going for the stories in the songs.
Okay.
And I was going for what I felt were the best of the songs. There's about 114 of them that he recorded. Some of them are really maudlin and don't weather well, but...
Well, there's the session he did when he was laying there dying of tuberculosis. That's
literally,
some
yeah.
of the most haunting music I've ever heard.
Well, the thing is that the world changes and it moves differently. And if someone's going to do a tribute to him and do those songs, some of them are just flat out pop songs, really, of the day. They might have been called Tin Pan Alley songs. But he did them in the rhythm of the 20s into the 30s, that rhythm and that moving, that way of moving them. And I wasn't interested in, if you will, copying that feel.
Uh-huh.
So that may be what you're talking about. I had a feel for them myself because I loved the songs and what they were saying and the melodies.
Yeah.
But I didn't want to do an old-timey style thing
sure,
on them.
Sure, sure.
It wouldn't come natural to me.
Sure. No, I thought you did a beautiful job with it. And one of the things I talk about on this show, people that watch this show know that I talk a lot about music from 100 years ago because the phrase country western or country music really wouldn't have been used at that time. In fact, there's Jimmy Rogers records that have Louis Armstrong playing his horn on it. And what we consider jazz versus country music versus soul music versus gospel was much more fluid. And this is why I started off asking you about Americana, because it's just sort of an umbrella term for a lot of music that I just think is great music. I want to ask you, though, I got to tell you, I love a lot of your songs.
Thank
you. My favorite song of yours is a song called Cellophane City, which is... I think it's your third or fourth record?
Third.
The third album. Is it Little Stevie Orbit? Is that the record? Tell me about that song, because I certainly wouldn't call that a typical singer-songwriter or Americana song. You're sort of tapping into something way more urban in that song. Where'd that come from?
It was just a song about a cheating song,
uh-huh.
and it was kind of a country song. But when we got rehearsing the songs for the record, Pete Solly, who had been a member of Procol Harum, was producing that record, and I can almost say I remember the afternoon he said, why don't we take it a little more into a pseudo reggae thing?
Yeah.
And we went with that, and it made it much better. So that was a good idea of his.
Do you still play that song live?
I don't, but I could get it together now that I'm playing a lot with George Naha on lead guitar, and we could get the hook, if you will.
I believe in you, Steve, and
thank
George.
You.
I just think that's a great, not only is that a great song, that's a great album. You have a song on there that I'm partial to because I'm from Philadelphia, and you have a song called Rain.
Yes.
Philadelphia Rain.
Yep.
Tell me about that.
That is a song complaining about how busy I'd gotten, really.
Uh-huh.
Running all over the place, and it was the other side of, if you will, success. It's like, well, I don't have a minute to stop and think.
Sure.
You know, and I'd like to relax a little now. So that's what that was, and I was spending a lot of time playing in Philadelphia. I was good friends with DJ Ed Shockey.
Ed Shockey, WMMR.
Yeah, and IOQ.
And what were the venues? We have a lot of Philly people that watch this. What were the venues? Do you remember where you would have played around then in Philly?
Well, we certainly played a lot. I started at a place called Stars.
Uh-huh.
There was a place called the South Street Music Hall. Does that ring a bell? It was over by Tower Records.
I know where that is, and it had a lot of different names.
Uh-huh.
But, yeah.
And then the Chestnut Cabaret opened.
Sure.
And I can't remember all the others, but the Ardmore and the Ambler and around the some of those clubs around the city.
So Ed Shockey, was he an early supporter of you in Philly? Okay.
He was. And so I was inclined to just write the song that Philadelphia Rain is Falling Down.
Uh-huh.
Philadelphia was very good to me, and we had some good shows down there. And my only regret is that I decided to call the song Rain, which is like, you know, there's just no reason to do that. It was Philadelphia Rain, obviously. Plus, there was a group from Liverpool who had a song called Rain.
Yeah, I've heard of that song and that band before.
So, okay, I would change that. I would call it Philadelphia Rain and be done with it.
I love it because being from Philly, you know, there's something about when it's raining in Philly. It's a dark vibe.
Mm.
It's a dark vibe. Philadelphia is a wonderful city, but I mean, it's kind of like when David Lynch lived in Philadelphia, he said, this is the most wonderful, horrible place I've ever been. You know, I'm glad to hear that you think that Philly's been good to you. I hope that we can get you back there soon. There have been so many venues that have come and gone, but you've been playing in our city for 45 years. I hope we can get you down there sometime soon. But Steve, I really want to ask you about your new record, Moving Through America. It's out on May 13th.
Yep. In fact, we're doing, if it's still news and this comes out before then, that day, May 13th, we're going to play the noon live show for XPN.
Oh!
So that is scheduled.
Here we go. Now we're talking. So May 13th on a Friday at the Free at Noon at the World Cafe in Philadelphia. Yep. You know what? I'm going to try and see you there.
Okay.
Wow. So tell me about this record. Did you record this album did you make this album during a time when you were not able to be touring and moving through America?
Yeah. Yeah, we worked on a cover record, Steve Greenwell, the producer, and I. We finished that, and it came out in early 2020.
That's a great record, too, by the way.
Thank you. It's called Early Morning Rain. And it was some of my folk rock singer-songwriter favorite tunes from my whole life.
You know what I love, P.S., that you did on that album is you did Supersonic Rocket Ship by The Kinks, which is, if you made a list of the top 30 most known Kinks songs, that would not be in it.
No.
But I always loved that song. Why did you choose that song?
I just felt like it was... it's very commercial. It's very upbeat. They did a take on it. Was kind of like Trinidad, West Indies or something with steel drums. And I always just felt like it could be a fun, straight out rock and roll song.
Sure.
And so I feel like somebody could have a hit on that thing.
It's a great song. And P.S., you did so many great recordings on that record. You did Pick Me Up On Your Way Down, which is a great old country song. And you did a fantastic version of Good Time Charlie's Got the Blues. It's sort of like a sampler of all the different things that you can do well.
Thank you.
But let's get back to, you put this record out, the covers record, and then the pandemic happens. Did you have plans that got canceled? Or
I had been writing songs as I do. All the time we made the cover record, which it took over a year to make the cover record. So songs were building up, and Steve and I were able to just move into, Steve Greenwell and I, we just moved into the original songs.
Yeah.
So we just really never stopped. We kind of kept going we were comfortable. And it did fall in a time when people couldn't travel. It was a virus. And so we were able to work here. Sometime we worked, we'd have, wear masks.
Yeah.
In the worst of it. But we just kept going.
And here you are making records like Fried Oysters that are these little, I don't know, snapshots of from all over the U.S., you know, these little slices of life that only, you know, a road warrior like you, songwriter, could pick up all these little scenes from all over the country. Was this the longest that you laid off from the road for a while? Or had, you know, were you used to taking a break this long from traveling?
No, it was definitely the longest. I don't really like to be off the road for more than 2 weeks. I like to keep playing and just to where the songs are second nature.
Yeah.
So it's definitely the longest I would ever be off the road, yeah.
How do you feel like sitting still in one place influenced, you know, the making of this record? And these songs about traveling.
Well, the songs were written on the go, so that doesn't figure into it much. It was just these are the songs, and now we can use this time wisely to record them. So that's the main thing, is just being able to. A lot of people did it. Many of our recording artists that we know, they made records.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So that was good. You know, if you were working at Costco or something, or the record store, you might have a problem. But two or three people could get together in the studio and keep at it. So it was a good thing.
Was there ever a moment, because I've interviewed a lot of people on this show before, during, and after quarantining, and a few artists have said, you know, I had a lot of moments when I thought, this is it. Maybe I won't be touring anymore. Did you think at any point that you might not get back out there?
Well, in the worst part of it, it was very uncertain. It definitely was. And I just, you know, no one was flying. That was unbelievable.
Yeah.
Around here with the Newark Airport close and Trenton Airport not far from
here. Sure.
For all the years I've been up here, because I've been up here for a long time before I actually moved here.
Sure.
And there's always planes in the sky, always planes overhead going somewhere, jets. So strange not to see any. That was shut down, and the frame of mind was maybe everything has changed, and maybe people can't congregate at all.
Yeah.
So, I wondered about it. Fortunately for me, and I'm not trying to say the virus was a good thing, but I'm just saying as far as keeping on working here with Steve in the studio, it was handy, and it you know, it was something to do.
Sure.
But what I'm trying to say is I'm in my 60s. So for me, I could live with the fact that I might not be at it anymore. If there wasn't any more club work or festival work, whatever. So I just always honestly felt like this would be worse and worst if you were putting out your first or second record, sure. and you really wanted to see what you could do and what it was all going to be about. So I've had several decades. So it was a little easier, I think, on me. I'm thinking of that song the band covered, I Don't Want to Hang Up My Rock and Roll Shoes.
Sure.
So, you know, at 27, you would certainly feel that way.
Well, and how does it feel now that you're getting back out there? What are these? How have these shows felt? And how have the audience reaction been any different?
They have been normal. George Naha's here. Wouldn't you say, George, they've been pretty normal lately?
Yeah, at the very beginning, it was kind of tenuous because people didn't know whether to come out. There were all the restrictions, and they had the COVID seating. A couple of the places we played, they had so few people that they allowed in. We looked at these kind of large rooms and go,
yeah.
This is different. But now it's getting much more comfortable.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You have a song on this new record called Say Hello to Gainesville.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems to me that this song is undoubtedly making reference to the great, late great Tom Petty. First thing I want to ask you is, because you've been doing this, just like Tom Petty, you are a road warrior. Did you ever cross paths with Tom out there on the road?
Nope. I worked with Ben Montinch, his keyboard player.
Yeah.
Ben played on the record in 1995 called Mission of the Crossroad Palms.
Mm-hmm.
And I did some experimenting, some production, and tried some things with Howie Epstein at one point.
Mm.
I think that was around 1990, maybe later. But no, I didn't know Tom, but I liked him a lot and liked his music. So for some reason, I started this song about, to my mind, it was just a nostalgic takeoff on orange juice commercials from the 60s. But by the second verse, it just took a little bit of a left turn and went toward referencing Tom Petty. And the Gainesville area, to me, is synonymous with Tom Petty.
Sure.
And at that time, In the first half of the 60s, I think Florida was covering 80% of the orange juice needs of the U.S.
Sure.
It moved on toward California.
Mm-hmm.
But so it became about Tom Petty's, you know, childhood home and all that. And so it became about Tom Petty.
One of the reasons I'm asking is because my band, Low Cut Connie, we recorded our very first album in Gainesville.
Oh.
In 2010, and about 5 years after we recorded it and we had finally had some success, I went back to the house where we had recorded it, and a block away, I saw a sign and it said Tom Petty Park.
Oh.
And I asked somebody and they said, well, you know, Tom grew up on this block and that was his middle school. And I got chills because I love his songs, and I never knew that we had recorded our songs in the same neighborhood that he grew up in.
You did the whole album without
knowing
that?
Okay. Yeah. Listen, I would be remiss if I didn't ask you about Romeo's Tune, which is a song that continues to resonate. I get excited when I hear it on the radio because I think, you know, great things last, you know. What is it like for you to play a song basically for 40 plus years? How does your relationship with the song grow and change over the time?
I don't think it's changed at all. I still relate to what the song says. I like the poetic element of it. And I like that people know it, of course, and like it. So it's never been a problem. Honestly, I never think, oh, God, I've got to sing it again for the 2000th time, you know. So I don't think it's changed much.
That's wonderful to hear because you still do it so well. And it's one of those songs that, in a way, you feel like it could have been written 2 years ago or 20 years ago or 200 years ago. It's just simple and great. Tell me about working with Bobby Ogden on that piano part. I'm probably going to mess it up, but people will recognize the... this. That thing.
Yeah, let's try to play it.
You want
to
do it? Let's,
yeah, maybe my voice is warmed up.
Hey, let's do it.
2, 3, 4.
By the great Steve Forbert. We're sitting right here in Asbury Park, New Jersey. Hey, Steve, best of luck to you. I can't wait to see you at the Free at Noon on
All
May
right.
13th in Philadelphia. I'll see you there. I hope everybody watching and listening to this show is going to go check out Moving Through America, your new record. And listen, take care of yourself, good health, keep the songs popping. It's great to see you, my pal.
Well, thanks for joining us here today, and it's been very painless. Ha, ha, ha.